3, 4. Rev up your engine. Liz Willows 09 says, "Hey Scotty, my car goes into gear, but it only revs up. If I reverse, it moves a little. And I put it in first, it barely moves. I changed the fluid and filters. My transmission done for?" Ooh, this is why I warn people about changing fluid in older cars. You didn't get the miles, you're gonna assume it's a high mileage car. Transmissions shift by fluid pressure, by the viscosity. An old dirty fluid, guess what? There's more friction, so it can actually pull better. You got a really old car with dirty fluid, you change it and put in new, slippery, shiny fluid, sometimes it'll start to slip, and that means it's done for. Let's hope all you did was not put enough fluid back in. If you didn't, a lot of times they will back up and not go forwards much. Pray you didn't put enough fluid in. But if you did put the right amount of fluid in, that's why when you do it yourself on any car, my advice always is don't believe any of the books or what anybody says, because you never know what's going to come out. If you can check the fluid first, or if it's one you can't check and it's never leaked and it's dry, you know it's full. Drain out the old fluid, measure it in quart containers, put exactly the same amount back in, then you know it's full, and the only thing you'd have to worry about if it was an older car is, I shouldn't have changed in the first place. But if you change it every 50, 60,000 miles and you've owned the car forever, just taking a little bit out that comes out, put it back in, you're not going to hurt anything then. But high mileage ones, it's a real iffy thing. So I warn people, don't go if it's going okay. If it's an absolute junker and it burnt, shifts like mad, clunks and slips, you might as well try changing it. What the heck? But if it's working fine and you've never changed it, it's often good to just leave it alone. Watch out, the Chinese are here and they're selling electric cars for $7,999. All right, how can they do that? Well, they're small cars, but, they can still fit 4 people. The thing is, with the tax credit, it would cost you $7,999. If you make a lot of money, because you got to make a lot of money to get the tax credit that's going to fully fund the thing. It's called the Condi K27. The actual price is $17,499, but with the incentives that you get and rebates and stuff, they're $7,999. That's a price that people can understand with electric cars. These are commuting electric cars. Their range is like around 100 miles. But for people in the inner city that want something like that, not a bad idea. Because if you look at it, when they were selling the smart electric cars, and they were cute little cars, and they had a range of less than 100 miles, really. Those things started at $24,999, and even with the tax credit, they were still $18,000 or so, and this thing is going to be $79.99. As I said, there's going to be some competition with electric cars. You can buy this little bitty Chinese one for that kind of price, and they're selling them in the United States now. This is the type of competition that's going to be going on. A lot of urban people, they want to have a cute little electric car. 100 miles is nothing to them. They're like, that's fine. I don't even drive 20 miles a day. These kind of things are going to build their way into the infrastructure. It'll be an interesting scenario to see how it actually comes out in the long run. But you can see already there's going to be lots of niches, and there'll be companies to fill the niches. And it's not surprising that the lowest price one is going to be from China, and they're selling them here now. Okay, here's a recall you want to know about. Ford is recalling over 375,000 SUVs that could have suspension problems that can cause accidents. We're talking about SUVs from 2013 to 2017 that were built in Chicago assembly plant. The rear toe links, it turns out, can break off, and then you're going to have steering problems. These links put more weight on the rear tires so you can have better control of the vehicle, since these are mainly rear-wheel drive vehicles. They're recalling them only in the northern states. All the salt on the road can corrode them away. Well, you know what I say to that is they should just have to recall them all. Who knows where you're driving, what your situation is. Take, for example, in Texas. You live in Galveston, near the ocean, that salt water eats up cars. It would be just as important if you lived in Galveston, Texas, to have it checked out under the recall, even though they're not saying that state is under the recall. It should include all of them when it comes to that. You might have some guy that lives in Arizona where they don't have any problem with assault, but maybe they spend the winters in Florida or someplace and they're on the beach all the time. And they should be forced to recall them all, not just pick states. Where they're getting kind of nitpicky with some of these recalls here, because of course they want to recall the smallest amount that they possibly can, because it costs them money. They're losing money on these things. It's not they just didn't build them right, didn't have enough anti-corrosion stuff, and they are corroding, which to me is a real no-no, because nowadays cars should not corrode like that. Even my mother's 2007 Toyota Corolla, which lived in Buffalo, New York, it did not rust because it was made correctly and it had anti-corrosion stuff. You'd think they could build them all that way. Tony says, I got a 2008 Saab 9.5 Aero 2.3T automatic with heat issues. Okay, I'm assuming you mean that you're not getting any heat out of the heater. And unfortunately, you have the wrong car for that for a cheap fix most of the time. The heating system that is all run by computers. But watch my video, How to Fix Your Car's Heater, Scotty. You get all the tips. Sometimes it's as simple as you're low on coolant. If you're low on coolant, guess what air does? Air goes to the top of the heater core. So when the coolant's supposed to be going through the heater core, exchanging the hot air with the cool air inside your cabin, if half or most of it is air, it won't work very well because water has a high specific heat and it'll give a lot of heat into your car, but air doesn't. So even if you had steam in there, it's not like it's a steam boiler. It's not made that way. It won't put on enough heat. So simple as being low on coolant can do it. Or your thermostat, say, is stuck open and you find out you're driving down the road, your temperature in the winter, instead of being halfway, is way under, just put a thermostat. Simple fix. Pray it's something like that, because in a Saab, all that stuff is ultimately run by computers, and there are a zillion things that can go wrong with those things. That's one of the reasons they don't make Saabs anymore. They were overly complex cars, and in the end, the company just went bankrupt. Titanium Cobra says, hey Scotty, what do you think of a 2004 Volvo S40 with a V8 in it? Someone I know is selling it to me for $200. The tranny's about to go, but when I think it'll be a nice car, it'll be my first car, so I can't afford anything expensive. All right, yeah, $200 for a car, that's not expensive, but you're talking about a luxury Volvo. Let me tell you, if the transmission is about to go, you're going to spend like 20 times what you paid for the car to fix. Don't buy that as your first car. You're looking for a first car, look for a $200 Toyota or a $200 Honda that still runs. Maybe there's bashed in fenders, maybe the paint's all faded away. I've had customers buy Toyota Corollas for $500 and they had a lot of mileage and the paint was faded away. Sometimes they drove them 5 years without all that many problems. Not that Volvo. Don't even think about buying a $200 Volvo if money is tight. You do not want to buy that car. Believe me. They can be excellent cars, but they're rich man's toys these days. That's a nice car. When it was first made, it's a very luxurious car. You don't want to buy that thing used with the transmission going out. Let's say it ran perfectly fine and it shifted fine. What the heck? You could drive it and it might last for a while. And it does, you get another car. You only paid $200, but don't buy it with the transmission going out. Now, here's one I have to give kudos to Mercedes. For people are going to say, Scotty, what are you, a hypocrite? You're saying good things about Mercedes? Hey, I tell the truth as I see it. It turns out that Mercedes-Benz is bowing out of autonomous car driving. They're saying that they're no longer going to be putting a bunch of money and research into cars that drive themselves entirely. They still have assistance programs just like all the other manufacturers do, but they're not going to do the fully autonomous driving one because they say if they can't do it competitively and be in the lead and be the best, they're not going to do it anymore. So they're pulling out. They're still doing a level 3 that helps it out, but they're not doing the fully autonomous level 5. They said, we're not going to be the best, so we're not going to do it at all. Well, I got to give Mercedes kudos because I see the self-driving stuff is going to be way, way in the future. And it's not probably going to be something that most people are even going to own because it would have to be in their own little situations. They can all drive together, yes, but you can't mix people and cars because people are too crazy and they'll do all kinds of crazy things. The computers can't figure it out and then wham. Mercedes-Benz, from my perspective, is doing the right thing. They're saying, we're not going to waste all our money making these cars that drive themselves because they're probably thinking it's going to be a long way in the future and who knows if it's even going to occur at all for the normal car owner. For fleets and stuff, maybe. But for the normal car owner, listen to Scotty, it's going to be a long time before that stuff actually hits the road, if ever. And Mercedes-Benz are saying, hey, we're not even going to invest in it anymore. MST4911 says, I got an 07 FJ Cruiser. When the engine is cold, I have a whirring sound. When it warms up, it goes away. It's coming from under the hood. It's got to be something that your drive belt goes. You know, in the old days, they were called fan belts because they drove fans. Now they don't because they're called drive belts. But a lot of people still call them fan belts. Well, whatever. When they drive stuff and the bearings start to wear, the bearings whir. You hear whirring noises. You can take all the belts off one time, say Saturday morning. The noise goes away. You know for sure that's what it is. Then you got to pinpoint which one it is. Grab the pulley, see if they wobble, see if they make any little noise. noise when you turn them. Now, sometimes they'll only make the noise when the strain of the belt is on it. So you got to leave the belt on. And in that case, get a stethoscope or any kind of noise listening device and put it on different parts. And let's say it's the alternator. And when you put in the alternator, you hear the whir real loud with the stethoscope on. You know that's what the problem is. Since it happens when it's sitting there idling, that's good because then it's easier to figure out. Let's say it only makes it while you're driving down the road. Makes it a lot harder to figure out because you can't be sitting inside the engine compartment driving down the road trying to figure out what the noise is. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.